Welcome to church this evening, the first weekend of fall, right? We can tell that the change of season is coming. So thank you for being here and gathering in God's house for worship. We didn't get a print in the bulletin, so this is going to be a test to see how well we remember our purpose statement. But let us recite it together. We share God's love by welcoming all and making a Christ-like difference in our community and in the world. So let's gather ourselves and worship God. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own way. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Our sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our first hymn this evening. Thank you. Let that love of God, the life of Jesus Christ, and the growth of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. And together we pray, O Lord God, merciful Judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in your doing your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. This evening I'd like us to read the psalm responsibly together. So if you would turn to that and then pull it down. From the 103rd Psalm, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name.
Bless the Lord,
O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the grave and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's. O Lord, we provide vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. You made known your ways to Moses and your works to the children of Israel. Lord, you are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. You will not always accuse us, nor will you keep your anger forever. You have dwelt with us according to our sins, not repaid us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is your steadfast love for those who fear you. As far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so you have compassion for those who fear you, O Lord. Our gospel comes from the 18th chapter of Matthew, and there we have these words. Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this is the reason the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all their possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me. I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slaves fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had on you? And in his anger, the lord handed him over to be tortured until he could pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
So I got you. So I got here in the temperature
is about 65 in here. And I thought that might be a little cool. So I turned on the furnace. And I think the furnace dust is bothering me right now. So I'm pretty certain that the gospel is about forgiveness. It says it in the first line. The parable is about it, pretty obviously. So what is interesting here is what the text is telling us about forgiveness and what it means for our living. Forgive seven times, Peter's question. Well, I can keep track of seven pretty easily. You can remember seven things. The 7 days of the week, the seven colors of the rainbow, the seven seas. An easy number. 77? I think I would need to make those little ticks. You know, 1, 2, 3, 4. And 1, 2, 3, 4, and another slash. And you know what? I'd probably lose the paper that I did that on. It's a big number. It's an extravagant number. And then in the parable of the king and the two slaves, it talks about 10,000 talents and 100 denarii. Now, denarii was the average wage of a laborer in that day. And laborers barely made more than a subsistence wage. They made what they needed to buy the food of the day and to buy the cooking of the day and maybe some clothes. 100 denarii in Jesus' day would be like 4 months of work. That's not a small thing. But a single talent out of those 10,000 talents was worth 6,000 denarii. 6,000 days of work. And if they worked like 300 some days a year, we're talking 20 years. A talent was not a small thing. But if you have 10,000 talents, you now have 60 million denarii. 60 million days of work. That's like 200,000 years. So the 10,000 talents is extravagant. It is the economy of a small country. Jesus is using extravagant numbers, hyperbole, to make a point. A point about forgiveness. Obviously, how much we have to forgive, how many times. But maybe getting at how much work it really is to forgive. A couple years ago, maybe it was just last year, there was a young black man on the witness stand in a courtroom in Dallas, Texas. He was speaking to a white woman who had been on trial. Amber Geiger was an ex-police officer who had just been convicted of murdering his brother, Botham John, in his own apartment. She had entered Botham's apartment thinking it was hers. And when he woke up, she mistook him for an intruder and shot him in the chest. At a trial a year later, Botham's heartbroken younger brother, Grant, took the stand. And he told Amber that he forgave her, that he wanted only the best for her, that he wanted her to give her life to Christ, something that his brother would have wanted as well. And then asking the judge for permission, he went across the courtroom, and Amber actually raced toward him, and they hugged, while she cried on his shoulder. It was an incredibly moving, courageous example of forgiveness, an extravagant example of forgiveness. And I don't know if I could have done that. In the late 1980s, my mother was mugged in a suburban Toledo shopping mall in the daylight. She had a glass bottle broken over her head. Remember when pop came in glass bottles? That's what it was. Two juveniles had walked away from a state residential facility for troubled kids. I wanted those two kids, those two punks, put in jail for beating up a white-haired 70-year-old woman. When we went to the first court hearing for those two kids, none of their parents showed up. I still didn't want them out in society. I was angry that they beat up my mother. They needed help. The case never went to trial. I guess they pled guilty to whatever charges against them. I didn't have to deal with them anymore. I never had to deal with forgiving them. I just forgot them. My mother pretty much recovered physically, though she didn't like to go to Toledo much anymore. But you see, I didn't have to say to those kids, "You are a child of God. And God loves you, and I need to love you too, and I forgive you." What Grant Jean did took work. I cannot imagine it was easy, but it was a conscious decision and conscious action to say those words to his brother's killer, to do those things. Even if she'd not set out to kill his brother, through horrible mistakes she did. And it was a conscious decision on his part to make those statements, do that action. Forgiveness is an act of our will. The extravagant numbers we heard in our reading also suggest that maybe it will be a long and difficult process. That it's not one time for all time. Rather, we may need to forgive someone again and again for the same thing. Not something new, but for what they've done to us in the past. Because something hangs around and it irritates us and enrages us and angers us again and again. And you know, being human, we have to sort of admit that it can be satisfying to recite to ourselves and others our grievances against people, what they've done, and what you think justifies your righteous anger. But all it becomes is fuel for rekindling the fire, the anger, and the bitterness. Every day in our workplaces, even in church, just human nature leads to injustices and conflicts and offenses. Sometimes intentional, sometimes not. We get hurt, we hurt other people. Having a nice little conversation with Jesus, just the two of us, would be nice and easy. There are real people to deal with, and they have to deal with you. not pretending that some actions not hurt us, that an offense doesn't matter, or that our Christianity requires us to forget past harms or say, but bygones be bygones. No. Forgiveness isn't acting as if things don't have to change. We don't have to keep putting ourselves in situations where we're hurt, or where we have to keep forgiving. Forgiveness is not assuming that because God is forgiving and merciful, God is not hurt and angered. The starting line of forgiveness is acknowledging that there is wrongdoing and pain, of harm. Whenever we talk about the need for forgiveness, we need to begin by recognizing and naming the extent of our brokenness. We were created for good. We were created for love and equality, peace, and fullness. We're image bearers of God. We're made for a just and nurturing world that honors that dignity. And we don't follow Jesus' example when we go our own selfish ways. Rather, we feel the consequences of it. And remembering this forgiveness too, we also have to forgive ourselves for how we hurt others and how we ourselves have hurt ourselves. One of the most valuable things I have learned from my years among you Lutherans is to say we are simultaneously saints and sinners. We are made in the image of God, first and foremost, and we regularly fall short. And God forgives us, and we can start again. We can always begin again with God. But for ourselves, we have to give forgiveness. Anne Lamott wrote a book called Traveling Mercies. And she has an illustration in there. She says, withholding forgiveness is like drinking rat poison and then waiting for the rat to die. We've got to give forgiveness. Because not forgiving affects you. Henry Nouwen writes, forgiveness is the name of love practiced among people who love poorly. The hard truth is that all people love poorly. So we need to forgive and be forgiven every day, even every hour increasingly. Forgiveness is the great work of love among the fellowship of the weak, that is the human family. The forgiveness to which Jesus points is beyond anything we're capable of doing on our own. It's God's strength, God's compassion, God's abundant mercy that makes forgiveness possible. Whether the transgressions were great or small, we live in God's love. We can do that. We can forgive in God's love. So God's world can be made whole for us and for everyone. There's an extravagance of love out there. There can be an extravagance of forgiveness too. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Just say, O God, thank you for your gift of love amongst us. Help us to live it. And God, on this business of forgiveness, walk toward it, to move with your desires. And then when we can't do it, count on you. Be the one to lead us and guide us to your great place for all your people. We are thankful that Jesus came to give light and love and to give it abundantly to all. Thank you, God. Amen. I invite you, if you're able to rise, for a confession of faith in the words of the creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Join together in the compassion of God. We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. You welcome us when we are weak in faith. Uphold your church throughout the world, making it a place of welcome. Strengthen faith through ministries of education and growth. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. The heights of heaven show us the vastness of your steadfast love. Have compassion on your creation, selfishness has brought ruin and destruction. We look to you to heal, renew, and redeem your world. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Make your ways known to the nations. Speak kindness to our bitter grudges. Settle our hearts when we want to settle accounts with violence. Bless our leaders with patience and wisdom. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Bring healing and justice wherever harm is dealt. Provide vindication for all who are oppressed. Free victims of human trafficking and forced labor. Deliver all who are bound by debt. Feed all who hunger and guard refugees fleeing famine, poverty, and war. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Tend to all in need of your compassion. Hear the cries of those awaiting justice and those yearning for forgiveness. Give the community to the lonely and neighbors to the outcast. Shelter all who are vulnerable in body, mind, or spirit. And from this place we pray for Charlotte, Hannah-Laura, family, Gordon and Dorothy, Alicia, Jan, Don, Larry, Marge, Vicki, Michelle, Bethany, Joanne, Deb's family, Kay, Diane, Tammy, Harold, Jim, Emma, Bishop Craig, Ann, Jeannie, Ann, Eric, Laura, Hazel, Sharon, Laura, Rob, Donna, Becky, Jody, Stephanie, Charlotte, Jamie, Barb, Betty, Maria, Emily, Liz, Lucas, David and Edna, Joseph, Scott, Cody. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Teach us to forgive. Remind us that you do not always accuse us. Still our tongues when we are tempted to pass judgments and argue over opinions. Make this congregation a community of mercy for one another and for all our neighbors. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. O God, on this weekend, we remember the victims of 9/11, the devastating loss of that day, and the pain that lingers. We also remember, O God, we came together as a nation to move forward. Let us keep that unity alive. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. O God, grant all leaders of the world wisdom and understanding as we continue to deal with this disease and the economic effects that we provide for all people's health and livelihood. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. We pray, O God, for those suffering from the wildfires and fires on the West Coast. O God, please be with those people who have evacuated, who have lost so much. May your strength carry and sustain them. And may those around be your hands for them. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. We pray for our prayer partners of Peace Lutheran Church in Sparta and for the homebound parishioners at St. Paul Lutheran. O God, be blessing for them and to them. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. God of our living, we praise to you, we raise to you the thoughts, prayers, joys, and thanksgiving and concerns of our own hearts now. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. We remember with thanksgiving those who have died in faith. As you equip them, equip us with your protection and power, until with them we see your salvation. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. All these things and whatever else you see. seated, reflect on God's gifts and graces to you and what we can be for the kingdom. I invite you to stand as you are able. Then let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have set before us these gifts of your good creation. Prepare for us your heavenly banquet, nourish us with this rich food and drink, and send us forth to set tables in the midst of a suffering world through the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I invite you now to take out your communion wafers and to hold them in your hands. We are practicing receiving communion in one kind, in just one element. But all of God's gifts are available to us, because for indeed it's God's promises, his words and promises, that make the difference to us. Let us gather together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all time and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and who by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, you alone are holy, you alone are God. The universe declares your praise beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath. We praise you, O God. Generations bless your faithfulness through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, and into the future. We bless you, O God. We give you thanks for your dear Son, at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, and with us now. We thank you, O God. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, and then he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After the meal was over, he took a cup, and again he gave thanks. And he gave it to all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering his love for us on the way to the table and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering and within this meal, among your people and throughout the world. Blessing and praise and thanksgiving to you, Holy God, through Jesus Christ, by your Spirit in your church, without end. Amen. Gathered in one by the Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see the gift we have been given, the body of Christ given for you. Thanks be to God. Together, let us speak the Lamb of God. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Please be seated as we receive God's gift and know God's love. Thank you. come out this week. It is part of our adult class, and so if you were interested in participating in that, and you didn't receive the email of the Zoom connection, let me know, and I will get that to you yet tonight. Just this afternoon, I get to church a little bit after 4, and I saw somebody from the community drive up and put things into the little food pantry. We don't know how many times that happens. We have a lot of donations from the community in a wide variety of ways. And so I have probably mentioned it before, but this 6 months has been an interesting time of technology and of learning things and putting together what we've been doing, because it's been a rather hodgepodge. And in fact, if you notice a little bit different sound, it's because we got a set of speakers up there just for the camera. But in the honor of technology, the music tonight was played off of David's phone, the one where he sang. I don't know where we would be in this pandemic if we didn't have the technology and the connections that we could have had there. So that's a gift, and that is a blessing. So the new Christ in our home is here for, good Lord, October already. That's not fair. I got stuff to do outside yet. So I went kayaking last night, didn't get out as quickly as I wanted to. And so I came in just after 8 o'clock last night. It was fairly dark out there in the water, man. I'm glad there weren't other boats out there because I don't have a light. So the times, they are going on whether we want them to or not. I invite you to rise as you're eating. Go in peace, remember the poor. Thanks be to God.